it's not so obvious, but I just won it. I don't know.
That's a good way of doing it.
Well, it worked for me. And that's... Oh, it's 5 o'clock. It's 5 o'clock in the morning. So I shall now go to my theme song for the start of this hour, which is Alan Jackson. It's 5 o'clock somewhere.
Sun is hot and that old clock is moving slow, and so am I. Workday passes like molasses in wintertime, but it's July. Getting paid by the hour and older by the minute.
Been there, haven't you?
Yes, sir.
I've seen your boat there.
I've been to Margaritaville a few times.
All right, well, that's good.
Just tumble my way back.
Okay, well, just want to make sure you can keep it between the navigational beacons.
We're in the movies, I got it.
All right, well, it's 5 o'clock. Let's go somewhere.
I'm ready. Crank it up.
Let's get out of here.
I'm gone.
Okay, that was Alan Jackson. It's 5 o'clock somewhere, and it's definitely 5 o'clock here in Generate Radio Studio here in Duns. And good morning, Colleen. Colleen's back again.
I am. Good morning.
There's not much of your cake left.
Good.
Yeah, it was better than good. It was lovely.
For a non-cake person, I take that as a compliment then, because you don't normally eat sweet things, do you?
Well, I shared it.
But you shared it. Yeah.
I didn't eat it all myself.
You didn't let Kyle near it, did you? Because he can eat cake for England.
Yeah. Well, it's been rather hectic through there. At one point I was thinking there should be a webcam through there so that I can see what's going on through there.
Well, they're all in their pyjamas now.
Right. talking about sleep, trying to get right. You're just is this subliminally trying to put me off?
No, not at all.
Have you seen? Did you see the sleeping bag?
No, what sleeping bag?
Oh, I'll find it shortly. But
oh, hang on, it was a
like a shark.
A shark. Yeah. I did see
lovely.
That.
Yeah, all these things, references to sleep. Somebody else was sending me a message saying she couldn't listen in because she was trying to be quiet listening to somebody snoring alongside her, and somebody else reminding me about people sleeping. But no, I'm fine. Right, okay. Having said all I said to Ben about all my careful choice of planning. Tracks.
Yeah.
Well, I had 5 o'clock somewhere.
Yeah.
And then I thought, Grace Jones, I've seen that face before.
Oh, absolutely. Yes.
So I went to find it's not there.
No.
I went onto my laptop. It's on my external hard drive.
Oh, okay.
So I can't do that. But I've improvised. I've gone for another Grace Jones track. Because if you like one Grace Jones track, you might like another one.
I do like them all, yes.
So this is Private Life.
Oh, perfect.
Right, that was the lovely Grace Jones. very statuesque young lady, isn't she?
Yes, she's not so young now, I don't think.
No, that's right, okay.
But the way but we very, remember her.
Very statuesque.
Yes, and, yes, 6'2", I think.
Didn't take any nonsense from, was it Russell Harty?
Oh, yes, that, she slapped him. Yes, I remember that. Yeah, she was very controversial. Well, she is quite a controversial character.
Yeah.
And, but I love her music. I mean, she's very, I got into her through the nightclubbing scene, and obviously nightclubbing is a famous track. But I think what sticks in my mind about Grace Jones is my dad. And my dad is a very mischievous, very lovely person. And we used to go out, father and daughter, many a time. And every time we went out, we always got into trouble. So one time we went out to buy a new stereo system. Have I got time to tell this, by the way?
Of course, yeah.
Yeah. I know you've got to talk, so in between.
Well, I'll just say it,
Just talk over me.
Yeah.
And we went
I don't
to,
have to. Actually, I've realised if the webcam's there, I don't have to say anything. Because
no,
if people want proof, there's a webcam.
That's very true.
Okay, we're not recording it.
Very true.
But, no.
So we went into town, and my mother said to my father that under no circumstances are you to buy a new stereo system, because we don't need one. So, of course, Dad and I went straight into Bang & Olufsen and bought the most expensive one in the shop. So Dad, when he got home, he said to me, right, go and distract your mother and I'll take the old one out of the cabinet and shove the new one in and she'll never know. And that he did that. And then all summer long, I played him that album, Grace Jones, nightclubbing album. And I had my dad, who is, you know, was not no spring chicken, you know, dancing around to Grace Jones on his new B&O without my mother ever knowing. That's
well,
the way, yeah.
from the father of Lady Aird of Airdness, I would expect nothing less.
Oh no! Don't
yes,
tell
I remember that.
Story.
I remember that story. Why not? You've told it. No. Right. Okay.
It's going to come around and haunt me.
Grace
again.
Grace Jones then leads me into another one of my favoured artists, Saint Saviour.
Yes.
Wonderful Saint Saviour.
Wonderful. Yes.
I could play Saint Saviour all day,
but
I have kind of restricted myself. And what I didn't mention to Ben was one of the things that I was thinking about when I was choosing tracks was no repetitions.
Very good.
Because I was hearing what I'm repeating. I think I've told this story before. I heard an interview with Phil Jupitus, who was talking about corporate playlists and how committees in big radio stations will choose playlist A, playlist B, playlist C, and everything in playlist A has to be played so many times a day, everything in playlist B so many times a week, and playlist C has to get played less often. And to make sure that all happens, it goes into a computer and the computer churns out what is played and when it's played, so the presenters don't really have any choice over what's played, and there's a lot of repetition.
Our tracks are handpicked.
So I thought, I'm going to make sure I do not play the same track twice.
No.
And in fact, I tried very hard not to play the same artist twice. And I was getting away with it until Bill Dishink came and gave me a CD. He said, put that CD in, play track three. And it was only when I pressed play that I realised it was the Rolling Stones.
Oh,
and
right,
it started off with the Rolling Stones. So I played two Rolling Stones tracks.
Well, we can forgive you for that.
And the only other one was Tegan and Sarah. I played Tegan and Sarah's song, The Cure.
Yeah.
And I played David Guetta from his new album, one of the tracks on there. He featured Tegan and Sarah.
Oh, well,
they're my rules, so I can trust it.
You can break them.
Yeah, I can break it. Yeah, well, one of the five rules are 1, 2, 3, 4, and rule five is once you've learned the first four, break them.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, that's perfect.
So, rabbiting on about Saint Saviour, and so what I've decided to do is I'm going to play Saint Saviour's song that she produced just recently as a tribute to Grace Jones, because Saint Saviour also thinks quite highly of Grace Jones. So this is that very track, Saint Saviour, Grace Jones.
Yes.
Well, have you heard that before?
I hadn't, but I am a complete convert to Saint Saviour. I think she's absolutely marvellous, and her that music video that you posted the other day was just...
Oh, yeah, the most recent one for Tightrope.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah. And what you don't know is I'm going to persuade you to take me to her gig.
All right, okay.
I don't know, is it during the week?
It's a Wednesday night in Sneaky Pete's. That would be a pleasure.
Well, I hadn't. I thought I might gate crash that one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Oh, good, good. I like freeloading.
It'll be good to see her again.
Yeah.
And, I've just remembered something else that I need to put into my playlist. See, I've got my playlist, some of it's in my head, mm-hmm. and I just need to remember that I was given permission to play something else, and I'll come back to that after this next track, because Ben asked for Johnny Cash, A Boy Named Sue. Unfortunately, it's not in the system, and if it ain't in the system, I can't play it.
That's right.
But what I can play is Johnny Cash, and I love this song, Me and Bobby McGee. It's Janis Joplin's version of Me and Bobby McGee is tremendous.
Well, I have to. This is where my musical prowess gets.
Well, you might recognise it.
Dent, but I probably will.
I think it's a great song. Particularly, it was written by Kris Kristofferson.
Oh yes. Yeah.
I particularly like Janis Joplin's version,
yes.
as I say, because she's female. Johnny Cash is
female.
Yeah,
we go,
right.
Here we go.
Right, Johnny Cash, Me and Bobby McGee for Ben.
Yogahopas atni ticker om vor music. Yogahopas atni ticker om me.
Come on, man.
Detta Aaron song om me and Bobby McGee. Busted flat in Baton Rouge, waiting for the trains, feeling about as faded as my jeans. Bobby flagged the diesel down just before it rained, took us all the way to New Orleans. Just another word for nothing left to lose. Nothing ain't worth nothing, but it's free. Feeling good was easy while Bobby sang the blues. Feeling good was good enough for me. Good enough for me and Bobby McGee.
And yes, that was Me and Bobby McGee. Eventually, I was getting a wee bit worried towards the start there, but apparently I think it worked. Johnny Cash was trying to introduce it in a foreign language,
yes.
Perhaps German,
I'm
was
not
it?
Sure.
I'm not sure. I'm not that familiar, but I got the impression that he wasn't all that familiar with the language either.
No.
And he was kind of hesitant. But we got there in the end.
Yes.
Me and Bobby McGee. Right. Okay, as you noted, Colleen, I have been asking a number of questions to all the volunteers who have chosen to sit in that chair.
Yes, and it's like a hotspot.
This morning it is it's you.
You should play the Mastermind music.
If I'd thought about that, I could have downloaded and got it.
But chair.
No, it's not there. So, the first one is, how did you first come here about Generate Radio?
Well, there's sort of three stories, really, and I'll kind of try and merge them. The first one was Leonard Harper Gow, who no longer has a show, sadly.
Yeah.
Enjoyed his shows very much indeed. And I happened to meet him in another capacity, and he just made mention that he was starting a radio show, so that sort of logged in my brain. And then, secondly, it was a Parkinson's Awareness Week coming up, and I was searching for outlets to do some kind of promotion or awareness for that. And so I searched and came across Generate Radio. So those were the two kind of connecting things. And I remember I emailed Kyle and said, oh, by the way, I'm this person and I live here and I want to come in and talk about Parkinson's, if that's okay, and maybe we could do some kind of interview and stuff. And he said, sure, come in. And I came in, and I remember we had a long conversation, and the bottom line was, I don't know how quite I ended up with a show, but I did. And then we never ever did actually ever did the Parkinson's thing.
Right. yes, I remember your first show. It was very good. Yeah.
Oh gosh, I don't remember it at all. But I know it's a long time ago now.
It was a kind of one-off, standalone one to begin with, because I remember saying it was really good, and I looked forward to you maybe considering kind of coming back and doing some more.
Yes, and that's kind of the second part of the original tale has gone out the window now, which was your how did you get in touch with the radio. The reason I continue it, and alongside a lot of other reasons, is that it keeps my voice in action,
right.
if you want to say, because this condition causes a lot of speech impediments, can do, and ultimately patients can actually lose the ability to speak at all.
Right.
So for me, it's really important, while I've got a voice and I can use it, that I do. So it's quite selfish in some regard.
Well, there's nothing wrong with that. But but quite often when people talk about doing things for selfish reasons, it doesn't benefit anybody else but themselves. But your involvement here certainly benefits a lot more than just yourself, I can assure you.
Well, I hope so.
Yeah, it certainly does. So, you've kind of answered the second question that I didn't ask.
Oh, good.
Which was how,
having
heard about it, how did you get involved? So you kind of done that.
Yes.
So the next one, before we play some music, is what would you say is your most memorable moment of your involvement with Generate Radio so far?
Goodness me, you didn't say the questions were going to get tricky, did you? I have so many of them, really.
Just getting one back.
Yeah. What goes around comes around. Hey, I'm getting that quite a lot these days. There are so many of them, truly there are. I'm going to fail here big style, because I can't pick one particular moment. But I have to say that your 24-hour show last year was very, very, very memorable, and coming in the early hours of the morning with the sunrise was absolutely
that
terrific.
Photo shoot, and then you interviewed me during that.
The tables turn again. Well, Ben started that show, so you can blame him. So no, it's very difficult, and I'm sure you find it very difficult to define one specific moment. But I tell you what, I feel immensely proud every time I walk in the door. Every time, as soon as I cross over and climb the stairs, I get a groundswell of feeling, goodness me, here's a little station doing great things, and that's why I keep coming back.
Oh, well, thank you. I've got more questions, but some more music just now. And Ben was asking how I link things.
Yes.
And my playlist for the next hour is like the playlist for this hour was. You can see there's one song on it.
Yeah.
And that was pretty much what I had for this hour. But it's filling up nicely, because we started with, we had the 5 o'clock somewhere.
Yeah.
And then for you, I played a Grace Jones song.
Yeah.
And that led me into St. Saviour's tribute to Grace Jones.
Yeah.
Now, St. Saviour was the person who first pointed me in the direction of this next artist. Mm. She posted a video on Facebook, which is I think it's a marvellous thing, Facebook. It's great for keeping me informed about things. I know some people use it differently.
Yes.
Some people post things, I think, really that shouldn't be posted there.
Yes.
But the way I use it, I find it great for sharing ideas, keeping people informed. So St. Saviour posted this video and said, this is great. Basically said, this is great, have a look. Mm-hmm. So I did. And it was this another young female artist from London called Dimbleby and Capper.
Oh, yes.
It was the whole thing just seemed rather bizarre. It was a wonderful video. And I thought, that is good. So I started to sort of pursue and follow the career of Laura Bettinson, who is the real person Dimbleby and Capper died at the end of last year. She put that to rest and she's now resurrected herself. She's working under the name of Femme.
Yeah.
But she's also working as part of a group with a guy who used to be a producer with Radiohead.
Really?
And their project is based out in Los Angeles, and it's Ultra Easter. And a lot of visual components to this as well. But Dimbleby and Capper I think she's just an amazing person.
Yes.
And I drove down to Birmingham about a year ago to see St. Xavier, because St. Xavier was playing and she was being supported by Dimbleby and Capper, and I thought, I'm going. And I went there, and there were only about 12 people in the venue. It was St. Xavier give me a shout out from the stage. Said, this guy's driven all the way from Scotland to see me.
Fabulous.
And Dimbleby and Capper was there, and I spent quite a bit of time having a chat to her. And her parents had popped over, because her parents have a llama farm near Birmingham, so they popped over. Not llamas, alpacas. Sorry.
And I remember you came back. You went buzzing. You came back buzzing.
And this is the first time I heard Laura Dimbleby and Capper do a cover of this song. So this is The Crystals, Then He Kissed Me, as interpreted by Dimbleby and Capper. Short and sweet, that was Dimbleby and Capper with her version of Then He Kissed Me.
Yeah, very good. I enjoyed that a lot. Yeah.
Fun.
Must have been great seeing them both together.
Yeah, it was. Awesome. She's just, the pair of them just brilliant.
Yeah, brilliant.
St. Xavier's voice is just absolutely
stunning.
Out of this world. Angelic, to say the least.
Compared to Kate Bush.
Yeah.
A lot. And I can see that.
Yeah. And I've pulled up Ultra Easter on the computer here. A band formed by Nigel Godrich, who is the guy who was a producer working with Radiohead, Joey Waronker, and Laura Bettinson.
Lovely graphic on there.
And their videos are all kind of like that. It's that kind of imagery and the lighting. It's I think you.
Yeah, I like it.
Yeah, I would Google it on YouTube or something.
Have a look.
Right, okay, I've got another final question for you.
Okay.
But I've got a feeling that if you answer this, you'll start asking me questions. Drag this? At, no. My final question has been to all the presenters. What about your future with Generate Radio? Do you see it being much the same? Do you have plans to develop it or what?
Well, I have had a few hours to think about this, which I know is something the other presenters haven't had. So if my answer isn't a good one, then I've failed big style. I'm thinking about this a lot, especially in light of hopefully the FM situation, which we're all keeping our fingers crossed for, and there should be no reason why that doesn't go through. And it does then propel the radio station into a different kind of level, which is so important. And I think about my shows, and I think I'm probably, of all the presenters that come in, I'm probably kind of the least music savvy of the presenters that come in. And I don't, like you do, have this vast sort of encyclopedic knowledge of bands and tracks and goodness knows what. I play what I like, and I enjoy that very much so. And I think also about strengths and weaknesses a lot, not of other people's, of my own, because I think what happens in life is, as you get older, I think you are more accepting of the things that you are good at, and you try and hone out more of those types of activities, and you sort of give away the things that you might love doing, but you're a bit rubbish at. So I think about that and what my best fit is for the radio station, and obviously I want to do what Kyle and Oscar. A, what's right for me, yes, and B, what's right for the station, and C, what's right for Kyle and Oscar.
Yeah.
That was in the reverse way around. And I suspect that my role, ultimately, I hope so anyway, is probably going to go a bit more this way, where I would like, is that I feel that I have now, on a couple of occasions, brought some different presenters into the station and encourage them to do shows like the Red Popcorn Show with Athol and Jodie, and I hope was sprung board for me dragging Athol in and then getting Jodie on board and stuff. And now I've got young Kerry coming in the mornings, and she's getting there and she's doing a great job, and she's a lovely co-presenter to have. But I think that perhaps any new presenter wanting to come on and come to try the station out and for the first time doesn't want to fly solo, perhaps, that maybe if they had someone to present with. So there's a kind of guiding co-presenter.
Yeah. Mentor role.
Yes, kind of bringing on other presenters. That would suit me a lot.
Sounds good, but can I just pick up on one point that you said? You said you don't have the same in-depth knowledge of music as some people.
No.
What I would just like to point out is there's no reason why all the shows have to be music-based.
Of course not. No.
And I do listen to other radio stations.
Yes.
Obviously, when I'm in the car, I can't listen to Generate Radio because I'm such a cheapskate that I won't get I'll only use Wi-Fi on my smartphone.
Yeah.
But, some of the best shows that I listen to on the radio are there's no music.
No,
phone-in debate programs and so on. So I think that, there is scope to develop non-music-based shows.
Absolutely, that's probably more my arena, to be honest with you. Interviewing is something which I really enjoy, and again, you can play absolutely no music at all.
Yep.
And anyway, though, it's an age thing, but I'm now currently listening to much more Radio 4 when I'm not listening to Generate Radio than ever before, and all of that is to do with talk shows and subjects and
stuff. So, there's scope for development. Yeah. There's space in the schedule.
Yeah.
I've got space in my schedule for another track, and it's linked to Dimbleby and Kappa.
Yeah.
Almost a year ago, I got invited to become a judge on Coolin FM's Highland Uproar competition.
That's right, yeah.
And 88 Photography offered one of the prizes.
That's right,
Which, in fact, I think that time round it wasn't taken up because the winner wasn't able to come to Berwickshire to get a photo shoot.
No.
But the winner was Farita, an artist in Perth, Western Australia.
Yeah.
And one of the other prizes that I'd arranged with Laura Bettinson was that she would do, as well as doing her own stuff, she had done quite a lot of remixing for other people.
Yes.
So one of the prizes was an offer for Dimbleby and Kappa to consider remixing the winner's song.
I had to
word it very carefully because remixing is a kind of funny thing.
Yes.
Some people would shudder at the idea of anyone else playing about with their music.
Purists,
and some remixers would shudder at the thought of trying to remix something that they didn't appreciate. So I tried to couch it in terms that, the offer would be there.
Yes.
And if the winner wished to take it up, and if Dimbleby and Capper felt she could do something with it, then they could go with it. Well, Farita did want to take the opportunity up.
Very good.
Dimbleby and Capper did feel she could do something about it. It was quite interesting because when the results came back to me, I thought it was absolutely brilliant. It was stunning.
Yeah.
Farita said, it's not quite what I expected. It was good, but... Dimbleby and Kappa said, it's not really quite what I'm used to working with, but I think I've done something really
unique
with it.
Yeah.
So I thought, I got these two together, and at the time it wasn't licensed, Farita said she didn't really want it being played until it was properly licensed.
Yes.
But I asked her if I could please use it as a track of the month.
Yes.
As a one-off.
Yes.
I think I neglected to suggest to make clarify that a track of the month meant I'd play it once a week for the whole month, but I did
interpretation.
It. Interpretation. I did it, and I stuck to after that I stuck to my sort of agreement.
Yeah.
I redacted it from any recordings of the shows, and it's not on the studio computer. It's just on my laptop.
Yeah.
So I asked for Rita the other day.
Could you play it?
Could I play it again?
Yes.
Yes, please.
Oh.
And so, for one of the very few times that this will ever have been heard on radio, this is the Dimbleby and Kappa remix of Farita's Karma. And that was Dimbleby and Kappa's remix version of Farita's Karma.
Well, I think that's a triumph, actually.
Yeah.
And I like the fact that two people come together and then they produce something unexpected, and they both felt it was unexpected, and it probably takes a bit of time for them to grow into it. But isn't that the catalyst for change? I think is what's important. And people, you can get stuck in a rut, can't you? A bit. We all get there. And sometimes when something comes left wing, it's a really good thing.
I'm being distracted. I'm trying to prove that men can multitask, and I'm failing miserably. But yeah, I think it's one of the wonders of this technology that we've got, that somebody in Perth, Western Australia, collaborating with somebody in London and producing something like that, and me up here getting it and.
Shrinking world.
Right. I'll play one short track, almost 2.5 minutes, and it's the reason I'm playing it is because I remember you wearing a pair of leather trousers once. And this is
I'm a sucker for
Leather Academy and a track called Thoroughly. Short and sweet, again.
Yes, very good.
A lot of short little tracks this hour.
Yeah, I like that a lot. I think I've ever heard it before. I'm sure I haven't heard it before.
Probably not, because I tend to have a habit of playing things that people haven't heard before.
Yeah.
Which, good. I suppose we were talking about what people can expect from radio. And personally, I think the music is really, really important.
Oh, absolutely, me too.
But if people want to listen to lots and lots of music. There's so many other ways they can do it nowadays with
Spotify
yeah. their own shuffles on iTunes and iPods and smartphones. And I think it's important pop music is played, but I think it's almost more important what happens in between the tracks.
Yes, that's the individual.
What really, really would put me off any radio show would be hearing something, somebody saying, well, you've just been listening to so-and-so, and their track is such-and-such, and coming up next is...
Yeah.
Now, if that's all you're getting in between, there's no point. I think it's really important that listeners get an understanding and a feeling for a personality in between so that they can become familiar with it. They might not like every presenter, but if there's some kind of structure and a pattern to the day, they know that the times they will tune in and the times they won't bother tuning in.
I mean, we do that ourselves, don't we? I tune into specific programs because I like what people are doing, and then I switch off when I don't.
Yeah.
But I also think that it's a way of kind of communicating which is it's not in your face. Do you know what I mean? Like all this stuff on YouTube and all this kind of visual stuff is very I think can get very tainted by what you see. Radio is that kind of thing which is just really nice. It's in the background, but yet it's got part of your it becomes part of your environment a bit more. It doesn't require you to concentrate fully on it. It's just
But going back to this interview with Phil Jupitus the other day, it was quite interesting. They were talking pretty much about how radio can be quite unobtrusive and you can get on with your life.
Yeah.
But every now and again, something catches your attention.
Yes.
And he says, you will often see people stopping and leaning in towards the radio because they want to pay more attention, as if leaning in that little bit closer is going to make it more intense.
Yes, it's funny that human behaviour, but
What I like about radio is you can get on with other things.
That's it.
And you can still appreciate what's happening on the radio, which with the visual stuff, the television, it's
that's right.
It's like a magnet.
Yes, you can't really truly multitask when you're watching something like that, but the radio, you can do other things, and something gets your attention, you turn it up a little bit, or it just stops you in your tracks. But yes, that's why I like it.
But I think the opportunity to do more than just let people listen to music is extremely important. Otherwise,
incredibly,
what's the point? Yeah.
Especially for a station like this, where the premise is that actually it's a community radio station, and it's all about different types of support, different levels of information, and different aspects of living in this part of the world, I guess.
It's a resource rather than just a service. We can do. Yeah, I think we can do one track, Born Slippy, and we can do the London Calling one as well, but perhaps that'll be after the top of the hour, because you're staying for a little while longer,
Another
hour. Yeah. Okay, so we've got...
one of my all-time favourite ever tracks, I'm hoping.
Oh, right, I'm getting confused. Right, Born Slippy, Underworld.